Hello, welcome again to the Death Labs podcast, where we talk all things security and threat research. Joined today by Casey Ellis of Bugcrowd, the founder and CTO. He's also the founder of the Disclose IO project. So today we're talking about all things vulnerability research. So welcome to our podcast.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Let's start with talking about the Disclose IO project, right? What is that and what problem are you trying to solve?
Definitely. So Disclose IO really came out of trying to, as a part of Bugcrowd, trying to get people across the internet to adopt, you know, vulnerability disclosure and or, you know, public bug bounty programs back in, 2014, 2015. So right in the kind of early days where it started to catch a tailwind. The thing that we noticed was that lawyers don't really understand this stuff if they've interacted with it for the first time, and a nervous lawyer tends to be a verbose lawyer. You end up with a brief that's like War and Peace and 11 pages long. And I mean, they're doing their jobs. That's fine. I don't fault them for that. But it was a problem that needed to be solved, because the other side of that is that you've got security researchers, oftentimes who are ESL, so English is a second language, and more often than not, like not a lawyer. Trying to pass through this stuff to figure out what they can do in terms of their vulnerability research that's like legal and safe and covered by, the tort law policies. So basically what we started off doing was condensing the language, like open sourcing how to condense a good security policy into something that was like easy to read, but as legally complete and bilaterally safe as we could make it. Mm-hmm. And Disclose.io kind of spawned out of that into a whole bunch of different things. Like we've got a policy maker that lets people, write their own, basically plug in inputs, create their own policy, create a security.txt output, a DNS security txt output, which is actually a standard that we proposed out of the project as well. It's like an incubator for like free stuff that helps people do VDP well, is kind of probably the easiest way to think about it.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you guys are the authors, the security.txt standard.
No, so we did not security.txt. We did DNS security txt. So the idea was it basically extended. We actually worked on an equivalent to security txt before Ed and those guys went off and did the hard work with getting it picked up by IETF and all of that. So that was awesome, because that was the part that actually needed to happen that they took care of. But looking at security txt, one of the challenges around it is that pretty much actually twofold again. In a large production environment, getting something deployed into the root of a web server at scale and then keeping it maintained is a nightmare. It's something that a startup could do easily, but if you're a large organization, it's actually a pretty horrible way to implement this type of mile marker. And on the flip side, any web developer could theoretically do it, and they might not necessarily have the legal blessing of the organization to say, hey, internet, here's our policy and here's where to send vulnerabilities. So to me, we were thinking about this. John Carroll and I were jamming one night, I think during COVID, when I was down here in Oz, as I am right now. and we thought, DNS is probably the most authoritative kind of midpoint, both from a technical but also from an organizational standpoint. How can we put records there instead? So we proposed this standard. It's actually been interesting, because it's a challenging thing to do. People don't like the idea of putting, crap in your DNS zone. I think anytime you propose something like that, you get an allergic reaction there as well.
It's a
sort of balance of the problems that we're trying to solve. That's been a really interesting one to work on.
I think DNS is usually highly controlled because the cost of error is quite high.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's governed, like the governance of DNS tends to reflect that as well. As opposed to, as I was saying before, the governance of a web server, sometimes it's really tightly locked down. But if you're out in the fringes of, UAT or whatever else, you can kind of do whatever you want. There's a spectrum of things that are possible there that just don't seem appropriate for, telling a researcher that you're not going to go to jail if you tell us if there's a problem. Kind of important to get that one right. So that was
that makes sense.
Yeah, probably another piece as well is just some collections of different things that have happened historically from a vulnerability disclosure standpoint. So there's threats.disclose.io, which is basically a collection of when organizations, agencies, whoever have used, DMCA, CFAA, like the Computer Misuse Act in the UK, the Crimes Act here in Australia, to chill good faith security research. So we're not talking about legitimate applications of those rules. We're talking about when people use it to basically say, hey, shut up, we don't like that. So, you know, researchers can actually post that stuff up into that repo. It gets, there's a bunch of people, Jericho, who used to work on attrition.org, which, mm-hmm. you know, if you've been around long enough, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. And if not, you probably don't. But he works on it in terms of, integrity and all those different things. And I think that kind of accountability side of it has been really powerful as well.
So, yeah, I mean, you mentioned kind of the history of CFA and DMCA and its use and overuse, you know, historically, and kind of the evolution of what that means in vulnerability research. I think, you know, before this, of just chatting before this podcast, right, is kind of my own origin story of, you know, I was a college student. Well, actually, my origin story is farther than that. It was DMCA by, well, what would have been DMCA violations when I was 10 of selling bootleg software, but I was 10. I had no idea what I was doing, right? You know, in college of just engaging in shenanigans of a university who really wanted to put me in prison, you know, and I just happened to be in a jurisdiction or within the territorial, apparatus or jurisdiction of a field office who just didn't feel like using, you know, the CFAA or Computer Fraud and Abuse Act as a way to just throw mischief makers, right, you know, into federal prison, which hasn't been true, right? You know, it's just dumb luck, right? Some other offices, you know, have historically been a little heavy-handed, right? And that's really plays into the evolution of vulnerability research and vulnerability disclosure and, you know, now to the world of bug bounties, responsible disclosure, coordinated disclosure. So, yeah, tell us a little, you know, your perspective of that history of the past 30 years?
40, I think.
It's been more than 25. It's close to 30 years now.
Yeah, it's a long time. And actually, as well, I think, you know, what we've seen, part of what got me pulled and like attracted to, but also I think pulled into some of the you know, collaborative threat intelligence and threat research space, is that there's similar gray areas from a legal standpoint. There's similar dynamics from a collaborative contribution, like collaborative crowdsourcing standpoint. So it's like, I know this from vulnerability intelligence. This is kind of cool. It's just being applied in you know, similar or adjacent or kind of other areas of security. I mean, look, it's been a ride, because I think, you know, what you're saying about the idea of actually getting prosecuted, Computer Fraud and Abuse Act in particular, that there's really not actually that many, the cases that you hear about that are good faith to actually make it to the dock historically, they make a lot of noise and they create a chilling effect, but they're actually quite rare. The more kind of obvious you know, observable, I guess, impact of some of the vagaries of how CFA is written is that, you know, like companies can write a cease and desist and invoke CFAA in that. Like a pretty famous example of that was when DJI sent a nasty gram to Kevin Finister after he, you know, tore apart some of their drone stuff and said, oh, you know, this is violation of CFAA, blah, blah, blah. And it actually kind of, they sort of got it wrong and Kevin went ahead anyway, but most researchers don't have, you know, he's got a combination of an understanding of the law that's historically really strong. It's not his first rodeo in terms of pushing back on that kind of, you know, wet blanket letter. plus he's just, as a human, you know, a pretty, like he's a good guy. He'll push through and get a thing done. Most researchers aren't necessarily like that. So you end up with people just not doing, they're just scared. It chills them into their security research and not necessarily actually doing anything that's positive in terms of public safety, because they're afraid of it being misinterpreted, which is a stupid problem for us to have as an internet. Like that was the part, again, with disclosure, you know, I kind of described the technical piece before, but just at a system level, it's like, this is a dumb problem for us to have. Like, this is the, you know, the internet's immune system trying to do its thing, and we've got the equivalent of an autoimmune deficiency. So, you know, the idea of basically pushing on, you know, the Department of Justice, like firstly driving adoption. And obviously this ties into Bugcrowd, because Bugcrowd helps people run these programs. So there's a commercial benefit downstream for Bugcrowd as an organization if we create a change in the operating environment. But to me, they're kind of almost two separate things in a way, because the operating environment change has to happen regardless of what Bugcrowd does or doesn't do to capitalize on it. Yeah. So that's kind of why we forked it out, right? And it's been pretty extraordinary, because I think with the adoption of Bug Bounty, I think in 2014, 2015, that was what got the attention of the market, as a like kind of sexy way of rendering security research and getting people to actually like lean in and look at it that weren't, prior to that. So that was useful. But what happened off the back of that was a whole bunch of really kind of, insertions of vulnerability disclosure as opposed to bug bounty into like regulation, NIST 853R5 got it written in. There's, BOD 2001 out of CISA that popped out in 2020 and different versions of this all around the world. They're kind of really what they're doing is reflecting the fact that like, if you're on the internet as a company and you've had humans contribute in any way to the systems that people are using, there's probably going to be a mistake or two in there because humans aren't perfect. So it's not like this like shameful whatever. It's more a reflection of just like the realities of computer science and how it interacts with human creativity and the fact that sometimes that goes wrong, right? That's it. Yeah. So, okay, assuming that's true, we need all the help that we can get to find problems, and probably this discovery of those problems is going to be a creative process as well, because it's definitely creative when the adversary is doing it. So this whole idea of letting the immune system do its thing just sort of makes sense. And that kind of narrative, like that, I call that my kind of because math setup, because it's just like, the math just makes sense, right? This is a thing that should happen because physics kind of dictates that it's eventually going to be that way. It's been a long road. Like the whole thing was responsible versus coordinated versus vulnerability, the language around it, seeing changes in the law and all those different things. It's a lot of people have been working really hard on this for the past 30 years, but we've seen a lot of progress in the last three or so, I'd say.
Yeah, no, I think so. And you kind of referenced something that just, is of my own personal history, as I've done vulnerability research from time to time, but never really jumped into that world. I will find vulnerabilities in like crimeware and like panels and all day. Don't care because it's single use, right? If I'm hacking a ransomware database, that can't be reused anywhere else. Prior to bug bounty programs and a path to get it from point A to point B, one, the real money was intelligence agencies who would pay for this. And they're still paying for this. A bug bounty program is not going to compete with an intelligence agency wanting to do the work of intelligence agencies. And as a researcher, on one hand, find terrorists, whatever, protect us. On the other hand, I'm also not naive. The same tools can be used by organizations like the NSO group and, assassinating a journalist inside of an embassy. Mm-hmm. I do not want to be part of that world. Right. So I'll help find ransomware operators and hack their stuff. But there wasn't ever really an outlet by the time I was making kind of mid-career choices. Yeah. When I'm doing research, maybe I'll pop a panel, but I'm not really looking at phone vulnerabilities anymore.
Sure.
And I suppose I decide to redo something else. Right. Everybody can reinvent themselves.
Right. So let's go there for a second. Cause Australia, Australia is actually pretty well known for, by the way, as context, I actually live in San Francisco, born and raised in Australia, moved across there as we started Bugcrowd back in 2013. We're actually back here right now for birthday season and family stuff and whatnot. And then heading back. So I just thought I'd call that out because literally the first question I get asked in any conversation ever is like, so where do you live? So I'm just preempting that. But the Australian offensive community. So if you talk about vulnerability procurement, basically I look at it as you buy a bug to kill it or you buy a bug to keep it alive. And those are the two reasons why that information changes hands. I've deliberately tried to avoid like black hat and white hat and good and bad and all those different things. Cause I think particularly from an international relations standpoint, that's far too fluid a construct to apply to this. It's more, if you're thinking about the economics and movement of information, the idea of what's the purpose of that movement, I think is the easiest place to kind of, start at. But Australia's offensive community is very strong. It's a community I've been a part of for quite a long time. And the funny thing about it is that I took an understanding of the economics and the business model and some of the work that went into that side of it, so supply into, Five Eyes and different things like that, into Bugcrowd. The funny part was that, people didn't really start to understand or talk about that until, FBI versus Apple after the San Bernardino shooting, and then that whole thing coming full circle a couple of years later, and it, you know, the big reveal and all that kind of stuff. So now that's a really, that's actually, I think, a far easier conversation to have, and it's less loaded. Like back in 2013 through 2016, say, there's this idea that, like, if you're doing that type of work, you're you know, morally, it's morally wrong, full stop, because the internet should be 100% secure, and there's no such thing as a safety interest or a national interest or a public health interest. And, you know, my personal point of view is that being vulnerable is always bad, but exploits can be used for good. So it's really a question of equities and how you're kind of applying that whole thing. So it's, yeah, that's been a really interesting journey, because I think, yeah, that's we're still talking on the, like, the right side of the law, quote unquote. When you get off into doing crime, you know, that's when what you were talking about before kicks in. Like, Dan Kaminsky used to have this great quote, like, not everyone wants to be a drug dealer. And it's true. It's like some folk, you know, the reason that I don't get into that stuff, I'd probably make a fairly effective criminal. I just don't want to be one. So, yeah.
I mean, you kind of, you know, you can eat well or sleep well, right? You know, and
yeah, exactly right.
So I prefer plenty to sleep well, but in this industry, we make plenty of money, right? So
we're doing pretty good these days. So there's less of a reason to break bad. But yeah, I think explaining that, I mean, this is another metaphor I use a lot talking about, because the assumption oftentimes that we bump into in a Bugcrowd context is that hackers and even just people in computer security in general are automatically bad, because that's kind of just the narrative that we've had for the last three decades or so. But the way I explain it is that, you know, like locksmithing or lock picking, that's like a morally neutral skill set. It's dual use though. So you can be a burglar or a locksmith. You know, lock picking is the skill that you've got, and it really comes down to how you actually apply it and what kind of, you know, moral framework you put into that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think the general population is pretty comfortable with that distinction. They're just unfamiliar with it when it comes to computers, because the internet's still, I think, fairly new to most folks.
Yeah.
So, you know, the whole idea of just people getting their heads around it, and then policy tends to follow that stuff. If all of a sudden you got legislators thinking about it in terms of, like, my voting population actually are starting to understand that this is a thing, they might not understand how it works, but they've realized it affects them. I need to actually jump in and be proactive around it. That's when you start to see things change.
Yeah, no, I think so. And there's an expression I use when I've covered this in my classes that I teach in a university, is like the people who are really good in this industry, regardless of, I mean, pen testers, threat intel, you know, whatever, right? Have a non-weaponized criminal mind.
Yeah, 100%. Right?
You know, yep. It's you can think like that without being that, right? You
know, 100%. That's also, I love that, actually. I might co-op that. You know, the if I get asked about, because I, you know, people ask about the founder story and, like, oh, how'd you get into this, all that kind of thing. And from an origin standpoint, one of the things that I'll say is that you know, I grew up really enjoying thinking like a criminal but having no desire to be one.
Yeah.
Which is funny, because people in this space, they recognize that and they understand it immediately. Everyone outside of it, they're like, I can't empathize with that, but it's making me laugh, and I can kind of get what you mean. It's the same reason people like crime shows on TV. It's like, oh, you know, there's a fascination and even in some ways a respect. You know, to me, like, criminals are entrepreneurs without rules, right? And there's a lot you can actually learn from that without adopting the morality or the ethics of it. I think that last part is the part that people struggle with.
Right.
I still think it's true.
Yeah. I mean, human beings are creatures of convention, right? We just follow convention by default. That's most people. If you say, how are you? You know, responding to that with, you know, my wife left me, you know, the kids won't talk to me, just like unloading how we really are, is just not what we do by convention. And most people follow it. And computers, when everybody follows the convention, they work great. The problem is, you know, software engineers who also follow conventions don't go their use cases of what happens when somebody throws in, you know, a single quote, semicolon, drop tables.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the way I think about that oftentimes is that, you know, the role, I actually, like, to me, and, you know, the whole definite, like, what is a hacker? That's a whole debate that can go, it'll go on forever, I think. But you know, one of the things that I think about, probably the easiest way I can kind of conceptualize what I picture when I think of a hacker, is someone who takes a system, looks at its assumptions, and then tips it upside down to see what falls out.
Yeah.
So it's basically, it's literally opposite thinking. Like, let's invert everything that was assumed in the creation of the system and see what we can come up with. And it applies to, you know, obviously that applies to vulnerability research. I think it applies in a lot of different areas, actually, including entrepreneurship, funnily enough. But that idea of, you know, inverted thinking, you know, oppositional, like it's almost, you know, oppositional defiance as a service in a sense.
You
know, it can manifest like that. Like it's fascinating like that. And that's what I love about, you know, the stuff I get to do, the community, this entire space, is just the amount of creativity that gets applied into that, because we're ultimately exploring pretty much an infinite white space that's around all these things that people have built, to see what's possible and try to, you know, create better safety conditions really as a result of doing that, which I think is pretty cool.
Yeah. No, I mean, there's a social good behind it, you know, when thinking about it, because we, you know, the way technology exists, it's almost, we forgot all of our lessons about regulating capitalism from a century ago. You know, people build these great products, yeet them out to the market and say, it's up to you to protect yourself.
Yeah.
If we had a proper regulated system, our industry wouldn't exist, because products would be safe by default, right? Your car is safe unless you're drunk driving over curbs. You know,
yeah,
the wheels won't fall off. It's not on you to figure out how to attach the wheels to the car. The system is safe by default. Where in technology, here are the features. Here, you go hire security professionals. And oh, by the way, if you're a consumer, you can't hire nobody. You can download antivirus, maybe, and good luck. And here we are.
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, I think that condition is a funny paradox, I think, because, you know, it's a part of what has made the internet such a, you know, beautiful trash fire in terms of how it's changed everything. You know, it's not bounded by, theoretically, it's not, I mean, it still is, because people still own the pipes and all those different things. But in terms of the pure concept, and I think a lot of how it's played out over the past, you know, four decades or so, is really this idea of, you know, free transfer of information, and there's no accountability, there's no liability, there's no restriction, which allows it to go really fast and kind of almost mimic how, you know, the collective kind of neural network of the planet works in a way, which is wild, right? But, you know, the problem is that's like dangerous too.
Yeah.
To just completely let that off the leash. I think capitalism is actually a pretty good parallel, because, you know, humans, we like to think that we are going to, you know, do what's best 100% of the time, but the reality is that's not true. You know, outside of active malice, so you end up with all these kind of unintended consequences. This is one of my favorite things to say to, you know, folk that work at Bugcrowd, and even entrepreneurs in cyber. It's like, listen, you got to remember that our entire industry is not meant to be here in the first place.
No,
like, no one planned for this to like have problems with it. So like the fact that, you know, things get weird for us sometimes, and there's uncertainty, like we are literally operating in white space as an industry, and just knowing that and accepting that, I think, is actually quite useful when things get weird, or you know, as they often do.
They just get weird in new and more exceptionally horrific ways, right? There's no meat space equivalent of ransomware. I mean, the meat space equivalent is just people running around burning down hospitals and facing no consequences.
Yeah.
We have a global economy, a global internet, interconnected economy and society, and we have national law enforcement, and our, you know, we can't agree among nations how many countries there are, right? Because you have a handful of people. Some people think Taiwan's a country, others don't. Some people think Israel's a country, others don't, right? You've got these disputed territories. Where are the lines in Ukraine, right? You can't get consensus on facts. You're not going to get consensus on international law enforcement. So ransomware is going to continue forever, because this crime does pay.
Yeah. And because the internet moves way, way faster than any kind of reflection of consensus in policy, because it takes long enough to get the consensus to then actually codify it and roll it out, takes even longer. And in the meantime, like, how many packets have crossed the wire? Like, a lot.
Yeah.
So you end up in this position where I think there is that, like, I think we're well past that breakpoint at this point in history. I think that's going to become more obvious as we go along, and what the, you know, what the failure mode of that, and what the kind of the new state of it looks like. That keeps me up at night sometimes, because I can't see a future where we don't have the internet like fairly tightly carved off in ways that reflects, you know, international relations, agreements and alliances and all those different things. And I think at that point in time, the utility of the internet actually goes down by quite a bit, and it becomes quite a, you know, different place. But that's kind of where we're at the moment, where all those different things are being tested for all the reasons that you just mentioned. I do think, bringing it back to the user, I actually do think that the free market, I don't think policy is ever going to fully get ahead of this stuff without becoming like authoritarian and draconian, which is not something that I necessarily want to advocate for or want. Mm-hmm. So in lieu of that, the idea of, you know, free market and an incentive being the thing that tries to help people do better, I think that is a useful lever that's available. On the user side, you know, to me, it comes down to this idea of like, how do you make secure easy and insecure obvious? Because security is not something that people want to do. They want to do the thing that they're already doing, and security is a part of the construct of how they do that safely. So they didn't do it to be secure. They did it to do their thing. So therefore, reducing the cost of being secure, I think, is really important. If you add too much friction to anything from a control standpoint, the user's just going to find a way around it. And there's plenty of examples of that. But then insecure, you got to make that obvious as well. Because I think when we're talking about this stuff, you know, as experts, we dive into the detail, and, you know, the whole like locksmith burglar thing, like, you've got to literally dumb it down to that level if you want to have a decent sized impact on the user base, because they really don't understand what's going on. Like, they understand that they should be concerned. I think we're at a point in history where, you know, the average person considers cyber to be an extension of their physical space. I think COVID really drove that point home for basically everyone, right? So they're thinking about safety on the internet in the same way that they think about safety when they walk down a dark alley at night. And, you know, the limbic system's activated, and there's all those things going on in the experience of the user. They've just got no idea what to do about it.
Well, and I think a lot of enterprises don't know what to do about it, you know,
yeah.
Not holistically. There's a couple things. Yeah, use MFA, right? And MFA for the general user can be kind of complicated, right?
Yeah.
You know, I keep going, you know, one of the examples I'll go back, like, by dollar amounts of lost, the biggest genre of cybercrime, or one of the biggest, is romance scams.
Yeah.
There's not a technical solution to that. People have been, you know, people have been scamming romantic partners in meat space forever. Nobody rolls up on their first date and say, here's all my red flags, right?
It predates the internet by quite some time. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, humanity's been doing the same things forever. The internet just enables greater scale, speed, and over greater distance of the same stuff we've been doing since the early, more brutal documented parts of our human species antics.
Yep. But no, I think that's right. And this is honestly, that is actually a fundamental, I mean, I don't want to pivot that back into a Bugcrowd pitch necessarily, but talking about vuln disclosure is a fundamental primitive to the future security of the internet. Like, this is actually why this idea of like, you know, someone leaving their front door unlocked, someone else coming along and taking advantage of that. But then in the middle, you've had someone walk past and for whatever reason, observe the fact that door's unlocked, right? Like, that phenomena, we talk about stuff that's been going on for thousands of years, that's a thing that's been doing that same thing as well. So this idea of, like, you know, all of the, like, the infinite kind of failure states that become exploitable at the enterprise or the user level, and then humans as, you know, ultimately the last mile of being able to identify those and stay ahead of it as they adapt and change and accelerate over time, like, that to me is really the only kind of one of the only sustainable solutions that we've got, regardless of what comes over the hill next. Like, we weren't talking about AI and LLMs, you know, 9 months ago, right?
Came out of nowhere, right?
And that's been true this entire time. So, like, you know, we started before there was a concept of mobile AppSec, and then all of a sudden everyone was freaking out about that. Like, connected cars popped up, hit the scene in 2015, like IoT in 2017, election security in 2018, 2019. And that's just going to keep going. So we're going to have a new trash fire to deal with, you know, in 12 months time that we're not thinking of right now. And I don't expect that to ever stop necessarily, because we're going to keep innovating.
No, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, you mentioned AI ML. It's one of the few cases of here's a new genre of innovation where people are thinking pretty early on, right? You know, the regulators are all in already. And yeah, you know, nobody knows how to regulate it because nobody knows what it is, right?
Yeah.
You know, the regulations apply to, okay, how do you use it, right? It's a tool. You know, facial recognition for recognizing your friends and family in Facebook. The risk of harm, no big deal, right? Mm. Facial recognition for policing, all right, human rights violations, or facial recognition and recognizing protesters at protests to go throw them in secret prisons.
Definitely. You know,
right? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they're all examples that I've used because I'm getting my PhD in machine learning, cybersecurity machine learning. But means who's doing anything about security of machine learning? Right.
Yeah. So we actually got we've been working with OpenAI for quite some time. We landed them as a customer in, I think it was February of this year, when they had a VDP. But what they wanted to do was to basically get some more structure around the intake point. And they actually wanted to pivot it out to become a bug bounty program, because a part of their motivation, as it is for Bugcrowd, is to build out a community of folks to actually understand what adversarial ML and AI testing looks like, and like the difference between, you know, SQL injection and prompt injection. Like there's all these different things where I think there's a lot of concepts of offense and you know, just classical computer science that actually translate quite nicely into AI and ML, but it's very different because it's all gray. Yeah. Like the biggest thing is that it's deliberately not black and white, which breaks the brains of a lot of traditional kind of CSQA folk.
But at its core, it's the foundational, fundamental computer science problem, computer security problem, right? Is how do you safely process untrusted inputs? Exactly. And it's really difficult. And we haven't really, like, SQL injections are still a thing. Buffer overflows are still a thing. Yeah. Greatly reduced, right? And now we're just adding more ways to give untrusted inputs to computers to process things. Yeah. And to go back to a point you made, one of the game changers that I don't think people are treating in an ethical standpoint is in a machine learning AI world, who's accountable? Nobody is. It's just the math, right? Math can't be held accountable.
You know, I got asked that question on talking about connected cars before, like this is, you know, whatever it was, 20. This is the other part, is that I don't think AI has been dumped on the internet. I think the awareness of AI has been dumped on the internet, because in reality, like the flash crash of 2010 was a adversarial machine learning attack against the high frequency trading system, right? That was an active attack. You could argue that information warfare and a lot of the stuff that's actually kind of changed, I think, the overall political environment since 2016 or so, is a product of abuse of machine learning. So like we've been dealing with this stuff for a lot longer. I think people have.
Oh no, ChatGPT captured the imagination. Right? Yeah. You know, I got asked a bunch of things. It's like, I remember Microsoft Tay from 2016. The thing that ChatGPT did that Microsoft didn't was, we're going to limit the input to try to reduce the risk, because 100%. Microsoft Tay became, you know, a neo-Nazi chauvinistic chatbot in 24 hours. And of course, it did. You're welcome, internet.
Yeah. Yeah, so no, one of those ones where I think there's definitely this blur, you know, safety as a, because you talk about like there's these very clear and defined, you know, vulnerability categories, right? And then there's, I think, in a classical CS sense, a concept of, you know, a thing that, you know, it's a violation of confidentiality, integrity, or availability, therefore it's a security vulnerability. That's kind of easy to, you know, it's hard sometimes, but it's easier to put a box around. Then, you know, if you're talking about systems that are intentionally designed to be fuzzy in their output. And when it comes to accountability, this was the where I was going before, like a connected vehicle panel that I was on the security side. And we're talking about computer vision and training data sets for level 5 autonomy and self-driving cars, all that kind of stuff. And basically someone invoked the trolley problem. And it was so funny watching the car manufacturers just, because they knew the line of questioning. It was the first time I'd heard of it, but obviously I'd heard it before. But this idea of like, if you talk about the trolley dilemma with an autonomous vehicle, at the end of the day, someone's going to sue because someone's been hurt.
Right.
where's the chain of liability? Is it with the car assembler? Is it with the OEM? Is it with the people who build the model? Is it with the people who supplied the training data? Like, where does the, if you've got decisions being made that are safety critical, that are fully powered by this trained ML or AI construct, like, whose fault is the decision of that thing if it causes harm? And it was a really, like, to my knowledge, there's still not a great answer to that question.
Yeah. Whenever there's more than one finger to point, right?
Yeah.
You're like, now, so you're like, litigation,
that's
right?
That's a bit of a concerning kind of place for us to be.
Yeah, right? You know, at least from litigation, the answer is, if I'm the victim, I sue everybody.
Yeah.
Right? You know, so, and then just insurance companies got to hopefully create an actuarial model. And, well, the cybersecurity insurance industry is buckling because the actuarial models are actually really hard. Because the scale of the problem is increasing at a rate where the math doesn't work. And now insurance companies are finding ways to not write these policies anymore.
I think they've figured out that, I think their actuarial tables are decently populated now. And they've discovered that they've been, you know, insuring a bunch of 3-pack-a-day smokers for lung cancer. And that's probably not a smart move.
Well, That's another way of putting the same problem. Yeah, is and we don't have a good way of, or there's no good way to enforce hygiene, right?
Yeah.
You know, but you make a good point.
Yeah, so it's an interesting period. Like the liability piece, I think some of the stuff, you know, getting involved in the national cyber policy strategy rather out of the White House with ONC there, D there. Forgive me, the coffee's kicking in. It's like 7 a.m. here, so. It's all good. But the whole conversation around software liability and how do you create, like, how can this be something better than just caveat emptor as a user? You know, there's almost, from what I could tell, there was almost unanimous consensus around the fact that that's a problem that needs to be solved somehow. It's the somehow that is the hard
right. part. Well, here's the flip side. How much of this is built on open source models or open source software developed by volunteers where there is no commercial entity or revenue?
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't bleed a turnip, right? You know, if I put a software module out there that turned out to be insecure and caused $1 billion of damage, you could sue me. You know, I'm in a rental house. I have a 20-year-old pickup truck where the odometer is broken, you know. Not a lot of assets to be had here, right? You know, so you're not going to get $1 billion from me.
Yeah, but oh, by the way, I power half the internet.
Well, funny story. That's how I started selling commercial threat feeds. It was like free for 8 years. And then people started complaining that, hey, there's a false positive. We're going to come after you. And because all of these security companies were using it for free. And it turns out I was powering like half the security industry protecting things. And whenever, you know, and they were using it incorrectly against my guidance, but simply saying, here, his fault. And I'm like, okay, it's time for everybody to pay up.
Yo, Dean, fuck you, pay me. Yep. It's, it's been funny how this kind of conversations progress. Cause like, when you think about, you know, you're talking about the incentive of usage, you're talking about the incentive of creativity, you're talking about like free market capitalism as a construct that we're all working with, that, you know, is available for that. And then you're talking about policy and regulation, the things that are kind of more stick than carrot, and how those things work together. I think my overall kind of picture of where we're up to is that it's accelerating past its breakpoint. I actually think that, you know, as I said before, I think we actually crossed that bridge, you know, 3 or 4 years ago. But now it's becoming obvious. So the question of like, what do? I think that's a pretty fascinating and actually important problem to be thinking about, especially when you overlay all the fluidity in the international relations environment right now. And the fact that that's not likely to slow down either. I think all of those things together, it's like, all right, like we've got to actually get, these are technical problems, but the interface with humanity, is so kind of pervasive that they can get viewed purely as social ones. I think that's, I mean, to me, that's one of those ones where it's like, you know, I grew up on the tools and doing all that stuff. And I think, you know, the older I get, the better I was. But I've kind of retained this idea of looking at these kind of system level technical, social interface issues as engineering problems to solve, because ultimately they kind of are. Do you know what I mean?
No, absolutely. So I think, that I covered a lot of territory and more than I think we set out to. You're just kind of workshopping this beforehand. So, I want to thank you for your time. Like I said, hopefully everybody, got some value out of this, right? Just like I said, a whole gamut of things that we ran through. So you've been listening to the Death Labs podcast. We talk all things security research. We air every other Wednesday on all of your favorite podcast platforms. So whatever you happen to use, like, subscribe, do all the things. And, come back in a couple more weeks for more technical content. If you'd like to be a guest or want topics, feel free to reach out. So thank you, everybody, and enjoy the rest of your day.